changed with local genetic conditions.
Julián Manriquez Botello. Manriquez Botello was born in Zacatecas, Mexico, and received his bachelor and master of architecture degree from Cornell University and SCI-Arc, respectively, and was named director scholar in the latter institute. He is the director and founder of in.formation, a multidisciplinary, multi-scalar practice working between urbanism, architecture, art, and object. Its multidisciplinary projects include masterplanning, architecture, interiors, installations, furniture, and product design. Manriquez Botello embraces all scales as an opportunity to engage design research and investigate the relationships between territory, object, object, interior, inhabitation, event, and body product. Info Studio's work has been internationally awarded and published. Manriquez Botello's work is part of the XBIAU, Bienal Iberoamericana de Arquitectura y Urbanismo in São Paulo. Has been given various design awards in the CMAX International Awards in Mexico City. Julián has received numerous design awards from the American Institute of Architects for various projects, including a coffee cup made of chocolate. His practice has commissioned work in Mexico, Dominican Republic, British Virgin Islands, United States, and Puerto Rico. Current projects include the new observation booth and lounge for the Equestrian Club of San Juan, an animal hospital, and a public-private street space project. Prior to forming in.formation, Manriquez Botello was a senior designer at Toro Ferrer Arquitectos and was director of projects for the San Juan Knowledge Corridor, University of Puerto Rico's Botanical Gardens, and its Rio Piedras campus, all of which were in collaboration with James Corner Field Operations. Julián has been a visiting professor at various institutes around the world, including Cornell, Pratt, Polytechnic University of Puerto Rico, among many others. He is also an active member of AIA Puerto Rico, serving as a president, vice president, and also a board member. Please join me in welcoming Julián.
Thank you for being here. I know it's quite a leap of faith, simply because I don't have a website, so I'm sure those of you who try to Google me, you probably found zero to nothing. So in that regard, I really appreciate you being here, and on top of that, being hungry. Really, thank you. I would like to start by sort of telling you a little bit about myself, where I am based now, which is in San Juan, out in the Caribbean, just to give you an idea of quick geographic lesson. The island is about 175 kilometers wide by 65, that is to say, is as big as, or as wide, better said, as the state of Connecticut. And San Juan, it's where I'm based, it's right about there. And what you see, no, it's not an oil spill, it was actually an explosion that happened. It turns out that I found this image, I found it amazing. And within San Juan, the old city is back there. So our office is right there. As a practice, we consider meaning the seamless interconnectedness, that is to say, the unapparent due to the transparent integration of the natural, technological, economic, political, and ultimately human behavior as the complex host conditions architecture, the object, needs to inhabit, addressing physical, cultural, and immaterial forces as the basis for the architectural. As in this project where is the site is situated right there, but about three kilometers prior to the site, you see it right on axis, and how the driving force behind this proposal, where decibels are extrapolated as force, which directly impacts the outcome. But these same forces have the capacity to annihilate any individual endeavor, as seen here also, where the project stopped literally in the middle of construction. At the core of the studio is the belief that a bottom-up approach to the architectural, as it is a better and more stable, but to build a densely interconnected system built out of simple elements and letting the sophisticated behavior trickle up to ensure operational optimization, allowing the agency of the random, that is to say, the power of the accidental. As for example, running into these diagrams, well, they're not diagrams, they're actually, one is a spider web, the other one is a caffeinated spider web, meaning somehow it was the spider was given caffeine, coffee, and that was the outcome. As the basis for what I will show you, the project for the coffee cup. And so we embrace the power of the accidental, the random, as I was saying, to specifically gauge and alter the macro state of the system itself. It is not illogical, but intelligent, in maintaining higher level sophistication in its entirety, meaning the system has to adapt as this chance encounter occurs. Aggregation as a collective phenomenon has come to be the classic bottom-up behavior case study. And it's only recently that we have come to generate mathematical models on the movement from low-level rules to higher-level sophistication in an attempt to recognize patterns from which to extrapolate smart, adaptive, and robust growth. The speculative nature of the studio addresses design and how to design adaptive, flexible, and robust systems capable of introducing indeterminacy to the fixed and the solid. Specifically, through the diagrammatic technique, which introduces into our work qualities that are spoken, disconnected from an ideal or an ideology, random, intuitive, subjective, not bound to linear logic, qualities that can be physical, structural, spatial, and technical. We critically look at working techniques and modes of operation that have the capacity of unleashing the site's latent potential, either through material intelligence and flows or vectors found in the natural and artificial, that are often overlooked by the discipline of architecture. So I will start by showing you what I consider the small projects. And that is to say, where the idea of aggregation, or better said, the behavior of aggregation is much more evident. The first project we call the super dwelling, which is a social housing complex. I know when I was approached to design this problem, I remember one of Mexico's most famous architects saying he had only done one social housing project and he would never do it again. So we absolutely accepted the project, but with some hesitance, simply because I still had those words in mind. Just to quickly go over the site, it's about 2 kilometers west of the eastern side of the island. And it's a very narrow strip of land. And as in any project, especially this type of project, the developer, of course, as a first demand is to make sure that you can pack as many units as you can. And so for us, we began by asking a simple question: can we learn from social animals? And so as a quick charrette at the office, we quickly looked at different organisms that displayed social behavior, and we opted for option D, which is the breaching ants. They're called superorganisms because of their eusocial social structure, meaning as a collective, they function incredibly well. But as individuals, they absolutely fall apart. And so we began by looking at 3 relationships: environment to organism, organism to anatomy, and anatomy to trait. We discarded the first and the last because there is a component that is very much variable, which is the environment, and trait also because each one of these entities displays the same trait. So we opted for the middle one, which is to say the organism to its anatomy. So we began to look at what I call the all-over condition, which is to say, what do we do? And so we began to look at the relationship of the thorax to its articulation, head to abdomen, and head, thorax to abdomen. As a result, we get this diagram. We further analyzed it and subdivided it into 2 components to see which fares or which is more robust in terms of how we could deploy this on site. So we quickly began by sort of gauging and sizing by allowing quick numbers in terms of foot area and determined that more or less this would be the sizes, the minimum sizes to develop a unit. By the way, so we began to understand that all of this noise, the dotted lines, we could begin to potentially understand it as something that happens above or below. And so here are the specific numbers. And so we discarded that on top simply because we thought it sort of displayed the qualities that were not exactly in tune with the rest, meaning it's robuster and more, I guess, fat, if you will. And so we began by literally subdividing into possible types and sizes, meaning that with type A, we could have maybe a single bedroom apartment while also having two bedroom apartments and so on and so forth. Okay, so that was great, but how do we deploy this strategy if we understood this as a unit? So we began to look to packing logics, which basically look for optimizing how one sort of aggregates things into a specific container. So for the sake of the exercise, we did this sort of generic exercises where this sort of behavior begins to emerge by obeying that simple rule, and sort of these voids began to appear, which was great. But the bad thing is, once we deploy this, the site being very narrow, literally none of that survived. So we had to go back to the drawing board and understand that we finally understood that once you break one element in how it begins to agglomerate, how it begins to pack, then the first mover advantage, as Steven Johnson calls it, that breaks everything else. It means that we will no longer have the same result as the previous one. And so we deployed what we call the loose fit, which was this piece. So as soon as it appears, it literally throws off. It no longer becomes the optimized solution or agglomeration. But as it turns out, this one worked out much, much better than the others we had tried. And so how do we deploy this on site using these same logics? And this is how it begins to emerge on site. And then, of course, logically, we have to limit to our site. But then we sort of manage the information, meaning once we introduce the next thing, which was an infrastructure component, the road, we begin to understand that other things need to be introduced, meaning we introduce information or we manage information. Basically, how and when we introduce this. For example, obviously we need parking, but what if parking was paired with planting techniques? Well, you could say that we could plant cars instead of park cars, in a way. And so, by doing that, we had originally intended for having one big loop, and it was only in one direction, but we thought it is very, very lengthy to sort of park your car down here and walk all the way up there. So we introduced three loops as a way to sort of make the site a little shorter. And by doing that, all of the parking occurs in the same, by the nature, by the virtue of the planting logics. And so, in these courtyards, we thought that we could harvest, do gardening for harvesting vegetables and all that sort of thing. And so now we're literally looking at how the roof should behave in order to maximize and harvest rainwater. Also the bottom, all of these large planting trees, for example, one that is, we're thinking it could be a fruit bread grove, which is part of the local staple. And so this is where we are at. This is our ongoing project for the past 2 months. So this is a look at still exploring how this will work, and a quick look at what we think that courtyard might look like. Obviously, we're not we haven't deciphered yet the inner works of each apartment, so we cannot still give specificity to each of those facades. And that's where we're at this project. The next one is still ongoing. It's Coconut Grove. I did not give the name to the project. This actually show you this for one simple reason. And that is to tell you that at one point you have to question what your client asks you to do, and you will see why. Just to give you an idea, this is arroyo. All the texture you see here is actually a coconut palm tree plantation. And the site is the south of the island in a municipality called Arroyo, which is one of the smallest ones. And so this project, originally I was approached by the client, a previous client, because he had this site in this plantation. But he showed me this. This proposal had already been designed, so I asked him, so what is my role here? He says, well, no, I want you to be my consultant. Because there is a New York hotelier who's coming to town and is trying to develop a hotel in this site, which is next to his. And one of his proposals is to do a boulevard. And he wants to make sure that his project is somehow incorporated into that. Okay? So I literally said, okay, well, that should be no problem. Just go sit down and sort of give my input into whatever happens. But then I began to question that boulevard if it made sense to only incorporate it in that short of distance. This is a big deal because in the whole island there is no malecón, which is to say that that boulevard next to the ocean. And it's ironic because we're surrounded by ocean and there's none, really, literally. Well, maybe shorts, I mean short distances, but and so I began to look and question, well, what if that boulevard extends all the way to that. But that was not enough, really. So the bigger ambition, I became ambitious. So is it possible for this municipality to give back to its citizens the entire oceanfront? And if that were the case, this would be the first and only municipality to literally give its waterfront to the citizens, because private development has absolutely sort of not privatized beach fronts, but it's just very difficult to access some of those beaches because there's a lot of development that has happened. And so I began to look at the assets, and so found some opportunities. For example, if we were to extend that malecón throughout the site, then the only thing impeding it was maybe the lack of a bridge there. And so this, by the nature of the approach of the client, it would happen by itself. So we would have to convince, the only thing we would have to do is to convince the owners of these properties to allow us to run it all the way through. I mean, they have no choice because you cannot build anything from the water edge to 100 meters. So if there's a setback of 100 meters, so I don't think that would be a problem. And so by the time I showed this, the mayor was already in the meeting, and this is probably literally 24 hours after my initial meeting with a client. So as soon as they saw this, and I quickly showed them some ideas of what this might be. This is literally a 24-hour exercise where you would have a two-way road and parallel parking, pocket parallel parking, and very much offset from that, either pedestrian and bicycle routes. And I also went ahead and showed them this, which if you don't recognize, that is a footbridge in Australia. So I literally showed the mayor a quick idea. He was blown away because he didn't even mention that. He said, "Oh yes, that is our municipality." That's the only thing he saw. But what I'm trying to tell you is, because I dared move on beyond what I was asked, in a week I was at the governor's mansion presenting this project, and because of non-disclosure agreements, I can only show you part of it. I will only show you how we approach and solving territorial, meaning the scale of the territory and how we domesticate that. And so we first began to look at how surveyors domesticate territory, and that is to say, to break it into what the USGS has done, to break it into a kilometer grids. And literally this is how this grid is imposed on the territory. And so we just juxtaposed that. And we began to look at one of the ideas is on how to do wind farming. And so we looked at the prevalent wind direction and determined that was the best orientation, but by using the USGS grid, we literally get a 707 meter spacing, which, just in case you didn't know, the ideal distance between wind turbine and wind turbine is a 700 meter distance. And so we began to say, okay, well, if that is the case, could that be our first row where we set it back from any sort of development in terms to, in a way to avoid wind turbulence. And so that would be, sorry, and so this is the ratio to determine wind turbine placement, which is 1.5 distance. And so that's how we began to develop the grid for turbine location. Then you add the topography as a way to begin to eliminate possibilities, meaning we cannot have anything way up there simply because it's too steep and there's no way to get up there. And so we begin to add all these systems, and then this serves as a placeholder for what we're calling vertical farming. So we're working also with the highest level of government, believe it or not, and public policy, in order for any developers that could or want to come in here, they will have to contribute to paying these vertical farms. And so this begins to serve, this begins to generate new order systems. And so I can only show you up to this, but you get the gist of how we're breaking down the scale of the territory. What I can show you is this image, because it is from my client's, I guess, my client's development. No, and that's not his. That is not his proposal. I show you this because the way it's being worked, the bigger the footprint a developer leaves on the land, the more they will have to contribute to vertical farming, to vertical farms. Okay, and so to continue on what I call the smaller projects, under these circumstances, self-organizing systems use feedback to bootstrap themselves into a more orderly structure as a result. When many are not present, many meaning quantity, they become more rigid, less adaptive. So in this regard, it's very, very different. It behaves very differently from a large scale perspective. And so when it gets rigid, then the organization sort of almost freezes, if you will. So in that regard, I would like to begin by showing you a house that is pro bono work, actually. This is, the client is actually a construction worker for the general contractor that usually does all of the built work I have done. And so we really invested ourselves in the project, even though we were not getting paid. And this is basically the site is really, right next to this mount that just shoots up very quickly. And that's basically it. There's an existing house, there are two houses. This is the beginning, I guess, of a bigger house. But to me, the interesting thing about this place is that this is the original plot land. And my client's mother inherited it, and she built her home there. And in turn, she subdivided that plot to give to her second son, which is the smaller structure that you saw, which is there. And because my client was getting married also, well, she went on and further and subdivided the plot. And so for us, it was really a question of, okay, it's a very small house. It's less than 1,000 square feet. And so the logic behind this, or the intelligence behind, contained within this plot was that this just kept subdividing. So if we were to use that logic and subdivided not only the plot, but what if that line was not just a line, but rather a vector which has force and direction? Could that have an impact on the proposal itself? And we were betting that it would. And so by doing that, we literally designed the house so that eventually he could subdivide it into two. One with this bit and this one, and another one here, and you could enter eventually through some stairs back here. And of course, you will see later in the section that in order for that to occur, we will have to design this as double height spaces so that eventually you could create a loft up there, or a second room up there, or a studio. And so parallel to this, we were looking at also and where to go from here. And then that is actually the client, or at least part of him. And he's very much covered in this art. And we asked him which was his favorite. He said, the Joker. So we began to look at how to approach this issue. And we found this tulip. That when we sort of Googled Joker, that image came up. And so we processed that image so much so that we could get a grain and feel for on how to treat a surface. And so what you see here is almost like a sampling, like a sample for sampling. And then what you see here is the outline of each of the faces, but we understood that it was not about individually sampling, but rather would have to be like the total piece that would be sampled, simply because this texture came from a continuous condition. And so in that regard, we understood that we would have to look at the house in its entirety almost as a single piece And so this is the unfolded facade. So this is the north facade. This is the east facade, the south. And what you see back here is the west facade. And so the idea is that contained with this, within this house, it would be exposed concrete, very rough, because he would use, he literally is counting on all the leftovers from his employer. And so by that, I don't know when we're going to get to see this house finished, but I did tell him, because we did invest a lot of time. I actually showed him a dummy invoice just so he could realize how much hours he had put. And I told him, the only condition is to build it as it was designed. That's it. And this is what we think it would look like. This is obviously an old image. It is a much more sort of punctured treatment. And one of the reasons why we did that is because it would have to be cross-ventilated, meaning there would be no air conditioning. Just to give you an idea, if you think you're paying a lot in your electric bill, there you will be paying 3.5 times what you pay. So just to give you an idea, they only use fans to sort of cool themselves. So we build these models that he was incredibly impressed when he saw it. And so the next project, Barajas Internacional, it's an annex to a home, next to a golf course. And in our first conversations with a client, when I asked him what he did, he said, well, I'm a world traveler. He lives 6 months at home and 6 months, he said, in an airport. Those were literally his words, meaning he was always traveling for half the year. So we began to literally take those words to heart and look at various airports around the world and sort of try to diagram, or very elementally, try to diagram and try to understand how this would sort of feed back into our site. And the only way we sort of found how it would is literally if you only oriented both northward, simply because scale-wise, it's just not possible. And one way we dealt with scale was to understand that this, while in reality is incredibly huge for us, we would only have to just gauge more or less what that surface would be used for. And because we knew we wanted to use, because one of the requests from the client was to have a pool, a jacuzzi, basically an entertainment area. So we understood that maybe those two legs in our site would sort of be those ledges next to the pool, and we sort of size them to accordingly. So we literally began to articulate that diagram and folding it. And so the first fold you see there literally responds to generating a wall to give privacy from his neighbors. And so the second one was to give protection from the golfers, because he's right next to a tee. There's balls falling into his yard all the time. So he wanted to make sure that while he was cooking, he would not get hit. And so as a consequence, and once you sort of read how this behaves, this is the floor plan that emerges as a consequence. And this is the outcome. And sort of, I'll give you a quick tour from different angles. I just didn't bother. Another thing I forgot to mention, and I thought he was joking when he told me this the first time we met. he's somewhat of an exhibitionist. So I wanted to make sure that he was at least half his body was in the water before breaking that plane, because I didn't want to get in trouble with the neighbor, at least with the neighbors through him. That's him. And one more thing, I mean, given that the exercise becomes generic, I guess, because it's not operating inside, one of the things, when I said that we feed the information, one of the things is, in order for us to locate the jacuzzi, because there is so much vegetation, we wanted to raise that so we could sort of make a better use of the beautiful backdrop that is the golf course and the mountains. And so this is, once you're up next to into the jacuzzi and sort of see what kind of views you get. And so this is the way it relates to the existing house. So our proposal is basically this, this. And just so that you understand how it relates, that is the existing house, which is the existing corner there, and this is our proposal. It sort of opens to that corner condition. And just to prove it, you see that first fold that I told you about, which is the privacy fold? It literally is parallel to that, to this house. So that means it's perpendicular to their view. And this fold also is the sort of protection for the bad golfers back here. The next project is cono visual, which is translated to cone of vision. And this in turn comes from also from the client, which in our initial conversation, she was adamant about, literally, these were her words, "I don't want to see columns nor walls." So I took that to heart also and sort of began to think about how can we dissolve the solid. At least theoretically we could, if we align everything parallel to the cone of vision, then in theory, they're still there, you just won't see it because you have limited view angles. And so we began to explore that idea of using the cone of vision to begin to derive strategies, or at least generic strategies with intelligence that we could deploy as a way to solve this problem, which also is an annex to a home. And the commission called for literally a small bar and water features just to enjoy the outdoors. And so we understood that the logics or the intelligence behind these strategies that you sort of could push and pull to determine or just to understand that you pull or pushed according to the size of the project or the needed or as needed. So this is the existing house. This is the actual cone of vision. And this is the altered cone of vision, simply because this was a no-no. We could not alter the existing home. So we literally sort of had to adapt the theoretical model. And so we began by understanding that if this was to be deployed in west is facing this way, that means that the sun in the afternoon would literally be across the house. And that was a no-no. So we understood that we literally had to pull that top down. And also we needed to raise that front up so we could accommodate for the cross ventilation. But we also understood that we needed to pull in order to sort of gauge a little more length to accommodate all the program. So once that becomes specific through the site-specific information, we began to articulate that envelope, and as a result is this plan. And like I said, it's very small. That's just a bar. This is a sunbathing chair. And that's just a water feature with a small fountain back there and a small rock garden. And that's how this looks. Section. This is the outcome, where this is the sunbathing chair. The contractor wanted to kill me. He spent about 3 weeks trying to decipher that corner. So I'll also give you a quick tour. It's a very small project. We were given an award for this project. Literally, no one had won an award with such a small scale project, and then to us that was really rewarding. And so this is how it relates, or maybe doesn't, to the rest of the house. The next one is called Supernumerario, which is a dental clinic. With this project, we were given 2 awards in Mexico City. Just to give you an idea, when I went, I did my research, and the previous 2 winners of this award was Tadawando and David Chipperfield. So when I went, I had really no expectations, simply because just the competition was very stiff. So this is Yabucoa, which is also right, maybe about a 10-minute ride from the super dwelling project. And this is the older part of town. This is where a project is. And these are the conditions in which it plays itself out. It's a very unique condition because the owner owns all this land, which, if you can tell, it's probably 3 properties in one, and so it connects both streets. And so one of the things we wanted to make sure that that connectivity was kept and maintained. So one comes into the site this way and goes out that way, because this is a one-way street. We just thought it was best to sort of enter and go out that way. Plus, the best view is from that vantage point of view. So this is the existing condition. Literally, all you see in there was already in place. The floor was already laid out. I mean, incredibly beautiful stone work in the floor. And you don't see this, but these are Spanish tiles, and this was supposed to be arches. At least in the drawings, that's how it was drawn. And so because of time constraints, we literally only resorted to analogies in this regard. And so supernumerario refers to the overpresence of dental pieces more than are required. And by the way, we all go through this phase as kids. We all have, at one point, more pieces in our denture than is normal. And so we understood that, oh, by the way, in case you didn't notice, the structure, even though everything was finished in the interior, it was absolutely clustered off with no openings, and it was the owner's intent not to have any openings. So as a first, I guess, order of hand was to literally and forcefully allow natural light into the building. And so we literally call these cannons of light, because in that regard, it was very much forced. So these are the intentions behind the site plan, where the idea is that we plant this sort of vegetation with yellow flowers, so that we don't have to paint the yellow lines. And sort of this vegetation would have this kind of bloom, and this kind of bloom also. And this is the upper floor where one apartment that could be subdivided into more. This is the existing, like I said, I didn't make any changes except this wall, which had a funny angle there. Just said, no, it just looks strange. Everything else was really much intact, but the ceiling, the reflected ceiling, which was something that there was an opportunity there to sort of rethink that. And so this is the result of how we sort of understood that maybe the ceiling was also maybe the texture of the palette in the mouth, just like the canons of light sort of allude to those molar pieces. And because also in the dentistry, when you take your mouth x-rays, they sort of unfold your mouth into a single plane. Well, we thought that we could design also everything just like the other house as a single unfolded project. Well, and so this is the end result. So each one of these sort of frames different images in the landscape, in the cityscape also. This is the exit from the site to the main street. This image, I really like this image simply because the concrete has that capability of somewhat absorbing light when it's a very low level light. It sort of gets that tone by its nature. It's truly more about that color, much more grayish than cream. This is my client's son. So like I was telling you, if you really sit still, you could see literally the clouds go by, and it's quite a spectacle. Okay, and so as a last scale category, when it comes to organizing systems or self-organizing systems, they use feedback to bootstrap themselves into a more orderly structure. As a result, when many are not present, meaning quantity, they become more rigid, less adaptive. And this is something we could literally tell you that once it gets to this scale, there's no way to be flexible in terms of how we treat our projects in compared to the first one I showed you. So Pujina is a coffee cup, is the coffee cup I was talking to you about. And I literally want to walk you through my intellectual exercise. This is an invitation to design this. I was the only architect among 8 industrial designers. And because I am not a coffee drinker, I literally had to educate myself in what this meant. And so I literally went back to history and began to look at where coffee was born, which is was discovered in the 6th century in Kaf in Ethiopia, and from Ethiopia to Yemen, from Yemen to the Arabic Peninsula, and from the Arabic Peninsula to Turkey, and then from Turkey then we get the name kahve, which sounds very much like cafe or coffee. That's how we get our term. And so, as it turns out, coffee is the world's most popular drink, most world's most popular drug, better said, which I didn't really consider the drug. And so in researching that, I wound up finding out that about 80% of the drugs, at least in Spanish, end in INA, which is the equivalent in English to INE. And so I just thought it was fascinating. And so I began to question, if coffee is a drug, then what is a drug? And it turns out it's just a chemical substance that affects your central nervous system. And then as the research went by the 1820s, caffeine was already isolated in a more concentrated form. And so the question was sort of begging to be asked, can coffee kill you? And of course, that's an affirmative answer, but it would take 20, or the equivalent of 20 coffee cups to be intravenously inherited, or the equivalent of 5 grams in its concentrated form. Or if it's in the oral form, it would take 40 cups for coffee to kill you, but it would have to be in a very concentrated sort of period, or the equivalent of 3.2 grams. And so in the process of researching, I run into this study that a scientist in NASA did, which was to sort of drug a spider and see what it would its outcome be. And as it turns out, this is the drug naive, and the one on the right is the caffeinated spider web. He explained what happened in terms of how, I guess, neurotransmission happens in the brain, which is to say that when we think something, it goes directly to doing. But once you're under the influence, he argues that he cannot find those direct paths, so it has to be rerouted. So that's the way he describes this diagram or this web. And so we began to also look at, in terms of linguistics, what it means to order a coffee. And so it is very popular among Cubans to ask for puya, cafe puya, which is to say black, no sugar, and it's a very concentrated shot. But also, puya means this. And so the name was born, which is to say puya, black, no sugar, and drug, puyina. And so we had a name, but we didn't have an actual product. And so we began to understand that this diagram could be deployed as an operative diagram. So we began to articulate it, and we arrived at this. This would be the underside of the tray that would carry more than one. So this is quickly what it looks like. And so the way it sits on the tray, it sort of leaves just a footprint. And so, of course, we had to torture ourselves a little longer. We could have just said, yeah, this is made out of porcelain, but we wanted to be consistent with the thought process, and we began to question, what can we make this out of? And so we went back to the research and look for what are the materials in the raw state that are used for drug making, and we bumped into this baby, cacao, chocolate. Because it contains caffeine, it's also a drug. And so quickly, I'll go through this quickly. It was cultivated for more than 3,000 years in Mexico, and we get the name from the Nahuatl natives, chocolatl, chococ meaning the bitter, sour liquid, and atl meaning the liquid. And when the Spanish arrived, they thought chocolate was food of the gods. So for us, and it is still one of those questions where we still don't know what the pureness level of cacao should be in order for it to sort of be enjoyable with coffee. And so Pollina Overdosed is born. And so in closing, I would like to share these thoughts, not mine, Steven Johnson's. Most of all, we need to preserve the absolute unpredictability of our connected minds. That way we can keep open all options. As in the neuro retransmitter project, the image as a chance encounter. This image, I take credit for the image, but not for the object placed on this model's head. This little image, the story behind it is that I'm giving a desk to a student, and I'm trying to sort of point to her so that she could rethink the way she understood that object. And this student comes into the studio and interrupts me because she wants to make a public announcement. And so I literally said, I'll give you permission, but if you allow me to place this on your head. And she was shaved. The announcement she was going to make is that she shaved her hair because she was trying to do fundraising for her sister who had cancer, so she had shaved her head as a support. And so it is this kind of encounters or that for me the bigger lesson or the great lesson that lies in the power and marvelous unplanned emergent unpredictable power of open innovative systems, when built correctly, it will lead to completely new directions that the actuator slash author never dreamed of. It is in this spirit that chance favors the connected mind. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the fascinating talk. Before I open it up, I just wanted to ask one question for everybody to talk, think about questions. So it was really fascinating to see essentially sort of interpreting a respected like interpretation of a given information to create like these unique, and it's sometimes it's really, really different interpretation of the existing one. For example, like the bridge end to the layout of the buildings, to pixelation of the image, to a facade pattern, or literally like projecting the airport footprint onto a site and using that. So in sort of in this logic, I think that interesting process is actually enabling to create a very unique design, and it seems like it's quite an important part of your approach in terms of design. So my question will be like, what does information mean to you, and maybe elaborate a little bit on the process. I think you explained that at the last, but I think it would be really helpful if you can elaborate.
Yeah, okay, I think there is a very critical question in terms of how I understand, how I differentiate data from information. Data is what you gather. Information is processed data. So what differentiates each one of us is how we process data. And so information becomes useful, or better said, data by itself is nothing. Meaning, when you sort of search the web data is being gathered on you, and how how you sort of behave in terms of what you search, how you search. It's not until this data is processed through algorithms to understand behavior and also understand how and how to sort of deploy this new information, this processed information in terms of interface experience, then it becomes useful information. So for us, is really the whole process. One is data gathering, which is part of the research, but also once we process that data to yield useful information, useful meaning through the diagrammatic technique, basically we mostly sort of focused on that.
Okay, so I'll open the floor to the audience. Anybody have any questions or comments?
Thanks so much, Julian. Really, really respect the work. I guess my question has to do with starting points. It seems to me that the processing of the diagrams is remarkably provocative, remarkably thorough, remarkably precise. It seems that the starting points are incredibly diverse. And so, somewhat related to Dequan's question, I wonder how you arrive at the starting points from airport conversations to x-rays at tea, and maybe how many you run through before you arrive at the x-ray, say, and then related to the process question, I've arrived at the x-ray and then now let's go. And then it seems to me it gets remarkably rigorous, but it's how you find that launch pad that interests me.
From the outset, when I said that we look at the interconnectedness of things, I take that to heart. I mean that literally. For example, the airport project, it was a matter of listening to the client. He's the one that sort of threw the cue. He said, I spent half the year here, half the time in an airport. He didn't mean that literally. He just said traveling. In that regard, I took that cue directly from the client. When I presented this to him, I went through the process, and he literally sort of looks at me and says, he's a very bad mouth client. He's like, I don't understand what you just explained to me, but I like what I see. And also with the Conovisual, the Conovision project, it was the same thing. In that, literally, I have no idea why she would say I don't like walls, I don't like columns, and I say, well, listen, this has to stand up somehow. It took me 6 months to convince her to do this project because, one, it was strange given the context. But because she didn't tell me this, she has a structural engineer brother whom she had been consulting. So I would present to her, she would be very joyous. 3 days later, she calls me up, listen, I changed my mind. So in those two regards, it's very much about, I guess, like keeping an open mind, if you will, to whatever comes at you. In the case of the pro bono work, it was also the same. Just the way because I had to ask him proof of his legal ownership of the plot because I cannot design anything on land that is not owned by my client. His mother began to explain to me how this whole thing came about, which was she inherited a plot of land. So once you see that in time, you begin to see a pattern. It's a matter of sort of recognizing. It's almost like a pattern recognition kind of exercise. Plus, the other thing I didn't tell you, I mean, look, like any other exercise, if you do it long enough, you might just get very agile at it, and you might be able to sort of weave your way through shortcuts without having to do so many iterations. A lot of what I do at the office, I try to do at the academia, literally. So I'm sort of trying to like test those boundaries between practice and academia, and I absolutely think we should be more collaborative, just like the physics department does, between the theoretical physicists and the applied physicists. I mean, they work hand in hand. And for the example, the Arroyo project also is the same thing. It's literally understanding what's in front of you. It was all there. I mean, all the information we use, it's always in front of us. It's just, I guess, queuing in on something specific, something very elemental, and work your way through and let complexity emerge as a consequence of working very elementally, which is part of the essence of emergence.
Any other questions?
Well, thank you for being so patient.